I lift my voice to praise you. My concrete heart won't stop me. My concrete heart won't stop me. I'll sing like it's the first time. I'll sing like it's the first time. I'll leave behind the sinning. I'll leave behind the sinning in my soul. A home, you've given us a heart, given us a home, you've given us a heart, given us a home with you. Yeah, we're bringing you our praise, bringing you our lives, we're bringing you our praise, bringing you our lives, we're bringing you our praise, bringing our lives to you. Yeah, joy and pain we worship, joy and pain we worship.
Well, let's pray. Lord, we thank you so much for this day. And Lord, as we look into your holy word, we pray that you would speak to our hearts. We thank you, Lord, as we look at the Shemitah, as we look at the year of Jubilee, the biblical feasts, as we look at your resurrection, Lord, we pray that by the power of your Holy Spirit, you would speak life to us now. In Jesus' name, amen. If you'd like to turn in your Bibles to Luke chapter 24, Luke 24. I know it's easy for us just to look at the resurrection because that is what has changed absolutely everything. That is makes a difference every time anybody ever has to go to a cemetery or lose a loved one. It changes absolutely everything about it. So it's easy for us to know that Jesus is the resurrection and the life. But my friends, again, I want to take you back to this time. For the women who were there at the cross, who took down the lifeless body of Jesus, for the ones that were there that had been the last at the cross, now they're going to be the first at the tomb 3 days later. And it's so amazing as we look at this account, beginning in verse number one. Now on the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they and certain other women with them came to the tomb bearing spices which they had prepared. They had a grim task before them. They had been terrified in the days before them, locked in an upper room. Now they were going to take the body of Jesus that had been brutally tortured and clean it up and anoint it. I mean, imagine how horrible that job was. But the Bible says they came very early in the morning. The Bible tells us in Proverbs 8:17, I love those that love me, and those that seek me early will find me. We have a saying here. What is it? Read your Bible and pray every day. How many of you have seen the movie War Room? Raise your hand. I want to tell you, it is the number one movie in the land. Hallelujah. And if you have not gone and seen it, go see it. It will actually absolutely convict you on your prayer life. So go see it. It's the power of prayer. My friends, here's what we find in our lives. How many of us realize that worrying won't change anything? We can lay in bed all we want and worry about things. Jesus said, who of you by worrying, what can it change anything? But prayer can change things. On the way to the tomb, you know what? The women were worried. You know what they were worried about? Who's going to roll away the stone for us? When they got there, did they have to face that fact? And so it is in our life. Worrying is not going to change anything. How's it working out for you ladies trying to change your husband? Is that working out well for you? How about you husbands trying to change your wives? How's that working for you? It's a part of the powerful truth of the movie War Room. But again, prayer does change things. And so when the women get there, they found the stone rolled away from the tomb. Then they went in and did not find the body of Jesus. And it happened as they were greatly perplexed about this, that two men stood by them in shining garments. Now, obviously, these are angels. And in the Bible, angels always appear as men. But sometimes they appear as ordinary men. And in the book of Hebrews, chapter 13, verse number 2, there's sort of an obscure scripture, you know, just one verse, and it says, do not forget to entertain strangers, for by doing, some have unwittingly entertained angels. One of my favorite angel stories involved Marilee. And Marilee's my angel, okay, but that's not the story. Marilee, when she first went to Idaho, she was raised in Whittier, had never driven on ice before. She was working as a waitress early in the morning. The sun hadn't even come up yet, or it was just coming up. She was driving on the canyon edge, and she started to slide over off the canyon there at a long fall. And she said, all of a sudden, out of nowhere, four big guys came. I believe she had a little Volkswagen Bug or something. They pushed this car back on and helped her get to the top of the hill where it was all level there. She got out of the car to thank them, and they were nowhere to be found. My friends, the Bible says that we should entertain strangers because we have no idea when they're angels unaware. And for us, I think we're going to be amazed when we go through and get into heaven, the amount of times there were angels that actually were interceding on our behalf that we didn't even recognize. They were recognizable. And as they were afraid, they bowed their faces to the earth and they said to them, why do you seek the living among the dead? And again, my friends, that's a very powerful truth. Why do you seek the living among the dead? Jesus had some friends that he's very close to, Mary, Martha, and Lazarus. Jesus was a long ways away. He ends up getting word that his good friend Lazarus was sick. Now, this is interesting. Jesus waited two more days. My friends, have you ever asked something of Jesus and there's a delay and you're going, I don't understand what had happened? Well, by the time that Jesus got there, because he was a day's journey away, now Lazarus had been dead for 4 days. Martha comes out and she says, if only you had been here. It would have been different. But Jesus gives to her one of the greatest answers in the scriptures. From John chapter 11, verse 25, Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. And he who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this? Do you believe that whoever lives and believes in Jesus shall never die? Do you believe that whoever lives and believes in Jesus will never die? Because, my friends, that changes absolutely everything. That's why the Bible tells us in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 that when we have loved ones die, we do not mourn as those with no hope. I want to tell you something. I have seen pathetic things in my life. I've seen people clinging over corpses in a casket. And my friends, if that person was a believer, to be absent from the body is what? To be absent from the body is what? To be present with the Lord. Funny thing, do you know where the tradition of open caskets came from? It came from Christians, actually, because it's impossible for a mortician to put a smile on a face. And so what was happening, believers were dying and they wanted to use it as a witness to the unbelievers in the world. Look at this guy in the casket. He's got a smile on his face. That's where it came from. Now, I got to tell you, I've been a pastor for 40 years and I've stood at the head of lots of open caskets. You're not going to see my body in a casket. You know why? I've heard people say, gosh, he looks better than he's looked in years. That's not going to happen. All right. So here's the thing. The resurrection of Jesus Christ changes absolutely everything. Jesus becomes that first fruit, and so our loved ones are in heaven. Do you realize that in John chapter 14, as Jesus is telling about his own death, which we would say is an untimely death, wouldn't we? Jesus was in his young 30s there, all the miracles that he had done. Wouldn't you say that's an untimely death? You know, when people die at 95, it's time. You know, how long are you going to stick around for anyway? You know, but there's untimely deaths that people face. And at his own untimely death, this is what Jesus said. Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God? Do you believe in God? Then believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you, that where I am, there you may be also. I want to ask you a question. Have you ever prayed for somebody to be healed and they weren't? They went to heaven instead? My friends, is that the consolation prize? Oh no, we prayed for them to live and they had to go to heaven. My friends, we're all going to heaven. And that's why the Apostle Paul says, for me to die is gain. So whenever that time comes, and this, my friends, right here, right now, is what changes absolutely everything. This is why Christians die well. This is why the Bible says, blessed are the dead who die in the Lord from now on. Yes, says the Lord, for they cease from their labors. And the scripture goes on to say in verse number 6, why do you look again and seek the living among the dead? Verse 6, he is not here, but he is risen. Remember how he spoke to you when he was in Galilee. My friends, it's so important for us to remember the very words of God. And it says, saying the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and on the third day rise again. And they remembered his words. Then they returned from the tomb and told all these things to the 11 and the rest. And it was Mary Magdalene. My friends, I love this part of the story. I want you to think about, of all the people in the world, who is going to be the very first one that Jesus is going to appear to? Who's he going to choose to be the very first one? Well, first of all, it's a woman. Not only is a woman, but a woman by the name of Mary Magdalene that sort of has this tag to her, out of whom 7 demons had been cast. Throughout my years of being in ministry, I've ran into people who think they're too bad. And what they've done is too bad. God could never forgive them. And I want to remind you of Mary Magdalene. Mary Magdalene, out of whom 7 demons had been cast. It was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary, the mother of James, and the other women with him who told these things to the apostles. And their words seemed to them like idle tales. Remember that word, idle tales, and they did not believe them. Dr. Luke is writing this, and that word translated idle tales is actually a Greek medical term that means exactly this, a babbling that comes from a fervored and insane mind. So here was an excited woman, and Dr. Luke is saying, okay, it's babbling from a fervored and insane mind. What do you think she was saying? He's alive. He's alive. I saw him. Jesus Christ is risen. And none of them believed at that point. You see, my friends, we sort of think the idea that the disciples were waiting for Jesus to rise from the dead. The women on the tomb, they weren't waiting for that. The guys that were still waiting in the upper room, they aren't waiting at that. But I love this word in the Bible, but. But Peter rose and ran to the tomb, stooping down, and he saw the linen cloths lying by themselves and departed, marveling to himself at what had happened. And again, my friends, the linen cloths that were surrounding the body of Jesus would have been like an empty glove, the strips of cloth wrapped around. It wasn't like your bed looked this morning when you got out, you know, sheets everywhere. The cloth that was over the face of Jesus was folded neatly. When they saw where the body had been, and they recognized nobody could have stolen that body. Not even the body itself could have gotten out. It just wasn't there anymore. It's then that they began to believe. Now, my friends, the resurrection of Jesus Christ, one of the most powerful events in all of history. We read in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse number 3. For I delivered to you first of all that which I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures. I love that phrase, according to the Scriptures. That he was buried and he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures. That he was seen by Cephas and then by the 12. And after that, he was seen by over 500 brethren at once, of whom the greater part remain to this present, but some have fallen asleep. After that, he was seen by James, and then by all the apostles. Last of all, he was seen also by me as one born out of due time. For I am the least, this is the apostle Paul, the least of all the apostles who am not worthy to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. And I love verse number 10 of chapter 15 of 1 Corinthians. For by the grace of God, I am what I am. Say it with me. For by the grace of God, I am what I am. His grace toward me was not in vain, but I labored more abundantly than they all. Yet not I, but by the grace of God with me. Therefore, whether it was I or they, so we preach and so we believed. My friends, I want to tell you something. 40 years ago, right now, is when I asked Jesus Christ into my heart to be my Lord and Savior. And at that moment that I did that, I knew my life would be forever changed. I came from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom light. And here's the power of the resurrection. When Jesus Christ comes into our heart, I know my Savior lives. It changes absolutely everything. And in case you're here today and do not know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, before we go on, I want to give you that opportunity to make sure without a shadow of a doubt that you do. So I invite you to pray with me. Lord Jesus, I do confess with my mouth and I do believe in my heart that you are the Son of God, that you died upon the cross to pay the price for my sin. I ask you into my heart to be my Lord, to be my Savior, to fill me with the Holy Spirit that I may serve you all the days of my life. In Jesus' name, amen. It was a very dark day. But Jesus Christ changed everything about it. And I want to tell you something, my friends. We today are living in dark days. The darkest days that our world and our country have ever faced. And it's amazing as we look at what's going on in everything in the world. Today, is the 29th day of Elul in the Hebrew calendar, which is the day of the end of the Shemitah. The Shemitah is a biblical word from the Old Testament. We have to understand something. We date by decades, okay? We got the 60s, 70s, 80s. Those are decades. Jews never date by decades, nor do the Bible date by decades. It dates by series of seven. It began in the creation. 6 days, God created. The seventh day, He rested. He made it as a pattern. How many need a break every 7 days? You see, my friends, our bodies naturally need to rest. That was laid down. But here's the thing. When the children of Israel came into the promised land, they were farmers. The land was divided up between the 12 tribes. Everyone in those 12 tribes got an inheritance, which meant that you owned a piece of land. And again, they were all agrarian. It was all an agricultural society. And God laid out this principle, a principle to be able to sustain in an ongoing way. And that was this. You should work the land 6 years. At the end of that 6 years, you need to let the land rest. I'm a farmer. I want to tell you, land has to rest. When it rests, it rejuvenates itself. It is a proven fact, world around, that that has to happen. When Marilee and I were in Israel last year, we went to a Jewish farm that was observing the Shemitah. They had a big sign up, we're observing the Shemitah, which meant this, we aren't going to, there's a horn honking there, yeah. If that's your car out there, you just moved and your pocket set it off, no. That at that 7 years, he had a sign up there saying they would not plant the ground. So this is actually happening. It's coming to an end. Today is that end. In the Jewish biblical holidays, feasts, appointed times, tomorrow is Rosh Hashanah. Rosh Hashanah is the Jewish New Year. And my friends, in case you're wondering what year it is 5,776. You got way older here in the last 20 minutes. After that, there is 10 days, and then there is the Jewish High Holy Day, the biblical Holy Day of Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement, which is going to take place on Wednesday, the 23rd of September. We're having a special service for that night for Yom Kippur as well. And then the next day, even though tomorrow is the new year, there are these 10 days in which worldwide today, Jews are examining themselves because they no longer have temple sacrifices. So, you know, they've kind of come up a way where now the Jews will give money. So if you have Jewish friends and you want to hit them up for a good cause, now's a good time. Okay, they're trying to make things right with God. But the Day of Atonement, which is followed then by the Feast of Tabernacles. Now, all of these have biblical implications. The Shemitah. The last time the 29th day of Elul happened was in 2008, the biggest one-day stock market crash in the history of the stock market happened 7 years ago today. It fell 777 points. I find that kind of interesting. It didn't fall 776, 778, or 8. It was 777. It ushered in the biggest recession since the Great Depression. Exactly 7 years before that was 9/11. Again, the biggest stock market crash that happened. There was a reason for that one, wasn't there? You see, September 11th in 2001, our country, our world changed forever. The very symbol of American prowess, the World Trade Centers, America was brought to its knees by Islamic terrorists. And I remember watching that. And I remember thinking, finally, the world is going to wake up. Because Islam has always had a declared war against Christianity. The history of it is absolutely crystal clear. And I thought, surely now we're going to wake up for that. My friends, we are far worse off today than we were 14 years ago as we look at the events. But what else has happened in this past year, this year of the Shemitah? Do you realize last year at this time, the president was saying a group that was known at that time as ISIS was a JV group. And my friends, within lightning speed and a short order of time, ISIS, which is now just called IS, the Islamic State, the rise of an Islamic caliphate. You didn't even know what the word caliphate was a year ago. And now it's just common language, common word. That has all happened in this last year. And my friends, you need to understand something right here, right now, today. There have been more Christians martyred in this last year than all of time put together. There has never been a time where there are more Christian martyrs than what we're facing right now. As we look at what's happening, these are the oldest Christian communities in the world. Egypt, those Christians date back to the time of the apostles. Syria, Iraq. In Turkey, these people have been able to withstand waves and waves and waves of invasion. But today, they're being desecrated and unbelievable, horrible things. See, I think we as Americans ought to take in Syrian refugees, but I want to put a caveat on it. Let's only bring in Christian Syrian refugees. Then we don't have to worry about any terrorists coming in. Of course, that would take common sense, of which seems to be lacking in Washington on both sides of the party. And my friends, here's something else that's taken place since last year. Since last year, and always the great judgments of God, there have been things that set it off. For instance, in Babylon, Belshazzar one night decides to get drunk with the holy vessels that were taken out of the temple when the temple in Jerusalem were stoned. So he and his concubines, they began to drink out of these holy vessels and praising the God of stone and silver. And at that time, the very hand of God wrote judgment upon the wall, and the nation of Babylon ceased forever to exist. The judgment of God came. What's happened in our country since last year? Five people, unelected people, on the Supreme Court of the United States of America totally disregarded the American Constitution and redefined marriage, spitting in the very face of God. And my friends, I want to tell you, because God created the institution of marriage, only God can define what it is. And God clearly said, for this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. Jesus reiterated it in the New Testament. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. Does not even nature itself say so? And it is directly and arrogantly against the truth of history and humanity, but more important, the God and the creator of the universe. And the White House celebrated it by lighting up the White House in rainbow colors in opposition to the true and living God. My friends, just to remind you how far our nation has fallen, everyone in this country has seen glimpses of videos of an organization called Planned Parenthood that boasts about making money from selling body parts. And my friends, in lockstep, the Democratic Party believes that's the most important thing. And my friends, I want to tell you, There was a time in America where if that had been exposed, there would be such an outcry on both sides of the aisle that it would immediately have to be stopped. It is beyond barbaric proportions. Do you realize this last week on Capitol Hill, before Congress, two adult women testified they were the failed product of an abortion. Do you know what that means? It means while they were in the womb, salt solution was injected into the womb. For 3 days, they were being burned alive. But when it came time for delivery, there was a live birth. And the one woman testified, fortunately, the doctor was gone, because if the doctor had been there, she would have been strangled on the table. They called the ambulance. They both survived. She has cerebral palsy to this day. But I want to ask you a question. How many of you saw that story on CNN? How many of you saw that story on ABC, NBC, CBS, MSNBC? I cannot emphasize to you enough that none of those names that I said are giving you any news whatsoever. This happened on Congress at Capitol Hill. And my friends, you never heard one word about it, even though they said it in the halls of our government. Why? Because it is deliberate. And again, my friends, it is high time, because I want to tell you, the judgment of God, this innocent lives of 57 million babies that have been murdered are calling out to the God of the universe for justice. My friends, this week, the Iranian nuclear deal, in spite of the leader of Iran going on worldwide media and saying within 25 years there will be no Israel. In spite of the fact that Iran just announced they have found a huge area of uranium, enough to build as many bombs as they want. And in spite of these facts, our nation doesn't even bring it to a vote, even though 70% of the Americans know beyond a shadow of a doubt this is a bad deal. And my friends, we as a people of God, as this nation, by turning our backs on Israel, God help us. And as we look at these magnitude of events that are taking place right before our very eyes. Now, I want to take you to the biblical feast. What do you think of when I say feast? What do you think of? Food. That's what I think of. And so it's a bit bad translation for us. It's actually the biblical. These are holy days. These are appointed times. Now, I want to remind you that the Creator laid out in the book of Genesis, in Genesis chapter 1, the scripture says this. So the evening and the morning were the third day. And then in verse 14, God said, let there be lights in the firmament of the heavens to divide the day from night. Let them be for signs. In other words, signals. That the heavens above us would be signals and seasons. And again, the word for seasons are appointed events. For the days and years, let them be as lights in the firmaments of the heavens to give light to the earth. And it was so. Then God made two great lights, the greater light to rule the day and the lesser night to rule the night. He made the stars also. And God set them in the firmaments of the heaven to give light on the earth, to rule over the night and divide the light from the darkness. And it was good. And so the evening and the morning were the fourth day. Again, Jewish days begin the evening before. At sunset is the beginning of the next day, unlike we who date it from midnight. And so the Jewish day begins on this, and God had laid out in creation, I'm going to use the sun, the moon as signs and stars. And the Jewish calendar follows the moon. Passover is always unequivocally the full moon. And because it follows the moon, these biblical appointed feasts were set. And my friends, all of the seven feasts of the Lord have prophetic implications. We'll start first of all with Passover. That's the easiest for us to understand. Passover is where the blood of the lamb was slain. Well, what's that? What was that fulfillment? When Jesus Christ, as the Lamb of God, came and was sacrificed for us, his death upon the cross. Coinciding with that is the Feast of Unleavened Bread, which was biblically fulfilled with Jesus' burial. In fact, even when the Jews take Passover today, they take one piece of matzos, they break it, they hide it in a linen cloth and go hide it. It's a picture of the resurrection of Jesus. My friends, the Feast of First Fruits follows 3 days later after Passover. What happened on the Feast of First Fruits? Jesus rose from the grave on the first day of the week. What's the first day of the week? What day is that? Sunday. That's why we as Christians worship on Sunday. We're celebrating the resurrection of Jesus. That's what changes everything. 50 days later is the fourth of the biblical holy days. It's Pentecost. What happened on the day of Pentecost? The church was born. It was on that day that the Holy Spirit fell. We're going to get into that because as soon as I'm done with the Gospel of Luke, we're going in the book of Acts. Acts chapter 2, when the day of Pentecost had fully come. Now, I want to ask you a question. If the first three biblical feasts have prophetic implications, what about the last three? Do you think there's something that each one of those represents? Well, the first one that we come to is the Feast of Trumpets, which starts tomorrow. The Feast of Trumpets is an unusual feast because, again, it has to coincide with the moon, which means this. Some years, there's only 29 days in this Hebrew month that we're in now, Elul. Sometimes there's 30 days, depending on the moon and two people's verification of what they see from the moon. Now, I know that's rather complicated, but there was a saying that was associated with the Feast of Tabernacles. You know what it was? No man will know the hour or the day. I've heard that before. Where'd I hear that? Oh, Jesus said that. So my friends, what corresponds with the Feast of Trumpets? It is the rapture of the church, of which we do not know when that will happen. Again, in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, the Bible lays out, and that was that chapter on the resurrection. I want you to listen. In 1 Corinthians 15, 51, behold, I'll tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in a twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, and no, that's not Donald, at the last trump, for the trumpet will sound and the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortality must put on immortality. Can your body fly through the air? Yeah, my body doesn't do so well flying through the air. It does pretty good at falling. But there's going to come a time at the trump of God. And again, in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, 15, it says, for this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord will by no means precede those who are asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout and the voice of the archangel and the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. The trumpet of God, the Feast of Trumpets. Then we who are alive shall remain and be caught up together with him in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and thus we shall always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. After that, the Day of Atonement. What's going to be the biblical fulfillment of that? Jesus Christ's second return at the end of the 7-year great tribulation. The Feast of Tabernacles, what's going to be the fulfillment of that? The millennial reign of Jesus. So my friends, we have three great events that are yet to happen. But I want to tell you, as the scriptures have said, as surely as Jesus came and he fulfilled the feast of Passover, the feast of unleavened bread, the feast of first fruits, it was fulfilled with the church being born at the feast of Pentecost. I want to tell you, Jesus Christ is coming again and there's going to be a trumpet call. I'm going to tell you, there is going to be the Day of Atonement when Jesus Christ returns and his feet stand on the Mount of Olives. I'm going to tell you, there is going to be a 1,000-year reign where Jesus Christ will rule and reign. Now, here's where it gets interesting for us again. As I mentioned for you, the Yom Kippur and the beginning of the year of Jubilee. Now, I'll try to make this real brief. We're in the Shemitah. The Shemitah has ended 7 years. The Bible laid out, after a series of 7 times 7 years, there would be the year of Jubilee. In the year of Jubilee, because every family was allotted land, so let's say you had to mortgage your property or sell yourself as a slave. In the year of Jubilee, it was all equalized. Your family got your property back. If you were a slave, you were set free. That's what it means. And my friends, that is going to happen on the 23rd. The last time we had a year of Jubilee, Jerusalem was again reconquered by Israel in 1967. Prior to that, when it happened, was 1917 in the Balfour Declaration, which guaranteed the Jews could go back to the land of Israel. What's going to happen this next year? I have no idea, but it's going to again be something big, and it's going to deal with the nation of Israel because God has a plan. In the short term, here's what's going to happen. On the Day of Atonement, for the very first time in the history of our country, a pope is going to be in the White House. And he's going to be speaking to the president on September 23rd. On September 24th, for the very first time in the history of our nation, the pope is going to address both houses of Congress. On September 25th, the pope is going to the United Nations to give an address to the entire world. And here's going to be his message: that the Iranian nuclear peace deal is a good thing. That one of the biggest issues that the world has to face is global warming. And that the United Nations need to adopt Agenda 2030, which basically says this: because of the global warming being the biggest part, we've got to surrender individual national sovereignty to a world organization that can oversee the entire thing. Also, at the opening of the United Nations, France is expected to bring a resolution calling for the carving up of the nation of Israel and a making a nation of Palestine. Up until this time, every single American president has stopped that. There is obviously no guarantee that it's going to happen now. So my friends, these are unbelievable days in which we live in. The judgment of God, the two biggest crises that we have, we're murdering babies and their blood is crying out. And our nation is about to turn its back on the nation of Israel. So my friends, it's dark. It's like the women that were on the way to the tomb that morning with a grisly job of anointing the body of Jesus. And they were filled with worry. Are you worried about the future? My friends, I don't think there is a person on the planet that's not worried about the future. Is worrying going to change anything? But I'm telling you, standing up for the Lord Jesus Christ, being a people of prayer, I believe that this nation can elect a born-again Christian as the President of the United States. I believe that there can be a revival that spreads and starts in the grassroots, the very heart of this country, to change that not only the White House is one, but also the houses of Congress, the Senate and the House has changed. The governorships in the states' legislatures can be changed. And a nation that is going so morally wrong can be turned right again because of the power and the life of the Lord Jesus Christ, who is coming again. Hallelujah. And I want to read one last scripture to you. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 1. But concerning the times and seasons, brethren, I have no need that I should write to you. For you yourselves know perfectly that the day of the Lord so comes as a thief in the night. For when they, not us. You see, the world is going to come and say, we have peace plans. Do you realize part of the side deal of the Iranian nuclear plan that they have is that Russia now has troops in Syria. And my friends, they have a nuclear submarine parked right outside Syria. And in case you don't know where Syria is, I can see Damascus when I go to Israel from its northern port. I can see Damascus. My friends, here's the reality. There is a prophecy that's talked about Damascus ceasing from being a city. We know what happened to the weapons of mass destruction that CNN and all the other liberal news media always came against George Bush on. Where are the weapons of mass destruction? We know exactly where they were. We had satellite imagery of it. They all went to Syria. We know Syria has chemical weapons. That's where they got them from. And my friends, there's a prophecy in the book of Isaiah that Damascus will cease to be a city. There is also the Psalm 83 war, where Israel's neighbors all converge and attack. Israel will not be defeated. But I want to tell you, all these nations around them are like piranhas. If they smell a weakness or blood, and the United States turning their heart against them, they're going to attack. We still have the Ezekiel 38 and 39 war that the Bible talks about, led by Persia and Russia. Imagine that. And so, my friends, for when they say peace and safety, then sudden destruction comes upon them as labor pains on a pregnant woman, and they shall not escape. But now I want to bring it back to us. But you, brethren, are not in darkness so that this day should overtake you. You are sons of the light and sons of the day. We are not of night nor of the darkness. Therefore, let us not sleep as others do, but let us watch and be sober. For those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who get drunk are drunk at night. You see, my friends, there's a whole bunch of people and there's a whole bunch of churches who have no idea what's going on. We do have an idea what's going on. Do any of you want to go home and get drunk tonight? And tonight be the night that Jesus comes? Any of you want to go get loaded tonight? How about sleeping with somebody that's not your husband or wife? How about that tonight? I want to tell you, the Bible's crystal clear. Everyone who has this hope purifies himself. Everyone, the word of the Lord is be sober, be awake, be a people who are watching and waiting. But let us who are the day be sober, putting on the breastplate of faith and love as a helmet, the hope of salvation. For God did not appoint us to wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, that whether we wake or sleep, we should live together with him. Therefore, comfort each other and edify each other, just as you are now doing. And I want to tell you, in those days and nights of darkness, the disciples, the women, they thought Satan had won. And my friends, in this day of darkness that we live in, I think it's very easy to start thinking Satan's winning. I have great news for you. Satan's not winning. Jesus Christ is coming back to rule and reign with righteousness. Hallelujah. We're on his side. So as the night gets darker, our call is to be the lights of the world and the salt of the earth. Amen? Let's stand. Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, we pray that in every one of our hearts, even as you have told us, two words, watch and pray. Even as you have told us, Lord, that when we begin to see these things come to pass, to lift our head because our redemption draws nigh. Even as you've told us, Lord, that that day should not overtake us as a thief. We should be a people who are waiting and watching. And so, Lord, we're ready for your coming. If it's today, if it's tomorrow, a year from tomorrow, whenever it is, Lord, we're going to wait for that sound of your trumpet. We're going to occupy until you come. And we're going to share the hope and the light that only you can give from being our Lord and Savior who promises, I'll never leave you or forsake you, even to the end of the age. Hallelujah. All right. If you'd like individual prayer, we invite you to pray with us. Again, Jack, one of our elders, is going to be at the back. If you have money that you either want to give or loan to the ministry for this property that we need to buy, go back and see Jack, and he'll let you look at all that. God bless. Have a great week.
Of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. And these are the days of your servant Moses, righteousness being restored. And these are the days of great trials, of famine and darkness and sword. So we are the voice in the desert, crying, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, so lift your voice, it's the year of Jubilee, and out of Zion till salvation. These are the days of Ezekiel, the dry bones becoming as flesh. And these are the voice of your servant David, rebuilding the temple of praise. And these are the days of the harvest, the fields are as white in your word. And we are your laborers in declaring the way of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, so lift your voice, it's a year of Jubilee, out of Zion till salvation comes. There's no God like Jehovah. 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 Trumpet calls. So lift your voice, tear of jubilee, out of Zion till salvation comes. Behold, He comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun, at the trumpet's roar. So lift your voice, tear of jubilee, out of Zion till salvation comes. From Zion till salvation comes. Out of Zion till salvation comes.
Praise God.